This is a very friendly and beautiful hall. The only problem is the height of that. Did you see that? So as a conductor, if you stand on the podium and you walk back, I hope they have a good insurance. Anyhow, my name is Itay. Itay, think Japanese. Can you say that? Itay. No, no, but I'm a conductor. You should say it together. Good, better. So now you know my name and you know what I do. And I'm here because of my wife. No, I'm here because I wrote that book, The Ignorant Maestro, which I aspire to be. I want to be an ignorant maestro. Right now, I am very much ignorant about you. I would love to know each and every one of you personally, but I don't. And yet, no, think about it. And yet, I presume, I hope, I will try my best to give you or to create something together which will, you know, touch each and every one of you individually. And I think those two are connected, my ignorance and my hopefully ability to do something with you. So first of all, with you, this is going to be a conversation, I hope. I asked him to put on the lights. But I really want to have a conversation, not a lecture. And shall we start maybe speaking about harmony? Do you use the word harmony in your life? Did it happen to you? Yeah? Usually with this before it? Or, you know, life. This is some. Anyhow, harmony is never a trivial thing, right? Even in very small organizations. Some of you might have experienced the organization which is called marriage. Some of you are smiling, some not so much. Sorry, can't help now. But even in a very small organization, marriage consists of two adults, yes, with some variations, but still, you know, relatively small and should be simple, but it's never simple. Now, think of a big organization, not huge, but big, a symphony orchestra. 100 people sitting on stage, each one equipped with an instrument of destruction. Acoustically speaking, yeah? Not everybody plays the trumpet or trombone, but even a violin in the wrong hands is a very dangerous instrument. And remember the last time you went into a concert hall just minutes before the orchestra starts? What are they doing on stage? Tuning. Oh, tuning is already a collective effort in which you tell your colleagues, guys, if we really want to work together, let's set a standard. Can we tune together? Let's tune. Oh. No. And the best thing I could do is leave now. This is all you need. You don't need anything more. So this is something I recommend each and everybody. But before that, there's something very individual. You come in, it's London. It could be, you know, quite cold. So you come in, and what do you have to do? Warm up. Now, when they're doing that, all of them together, what is it that you hear sitting in the hall? Disharmony. Another word? Noise, cacophony, yeah, all of this together. So this is a good starting point because it's very human, we know that. You put people together, there's always this thingy. And the question is, how do you move from that to harmony, right? So my first clip, little clip, is about harmony. It's a fragment of a little clip from a concert, and please watch it. Who would you like to give, I mean, if you think that was a good effort to achieve harmony, who would you like to go and congratulate for the achievement, okay? Tell me. Okay. So the musically inclined amongst you would notice that there's a little sync problem here. Doesn't matter. So who would you like to give the compliments to?
Composer?
Okay, nice. Who else? Who? Conductor. Okay, why the conductor? Who doesn't like this conductor at all, please? You mean, what is a conductor? Somebody who tells you what to do, right? Can you clap your hands together once? Not together. Again. Getting worse. So either somebody can stand up and say, 1, 2, 3, or I have to conduct you. Now, the thing is, this guy doesn't tell them what to do. What's he doing? What's his mood? The guy enjoys every second of it. That already makes him very suspicious. When you come to work, how come you have time for that? And the second thing, his body language is not that of commanding, but rather of dancing. The guy is simply dancing. Are you dancing when you're at work? I hope so. You're not? Dancing is not about about putting on music. Dancing is about, you know, if one of those gorgeous ladies here would agree to dance with me, and we would dance here, and I would at a certain point throw her into the air for a 4.5 meters pirouette above ground level, at that particular moment, something interesting happens, because over there, she has to trust me for being here when she's back. You know, if I got a phone call, just hang in there, you understand what I'm saying? So, dancing implies trust. Anyhow, this is a strange conducting. We're not used to see conductors like that. Who else was part of the harmony? What about you, the people in the audience? Of course, it was not taken here. It was taken where? In? Which makes it even more strange. Have you been to Vienna? Of course you have. Now, when you walk in the streets of Vienna, no offense, human warmth is not the first thing to jump at you. You see what I mean? So this is probably the closest to a Turkish belly dancing feast that they ever get to in the Musikverein, which is great, because that means that the audience actually becomes part of the orchestra, part of the performance. And it's a wonderful reassurance of, you know, our culture, et cetera, et cetera. So, what about the relations between... have you lately seen a poster advertising a concert where you have the London Philharmonic Orchestra in one line? Conducted by Valery Gergiev in huge letters, and down there, small print, people with minor contribution to the event, Mozart, Beethoven, you know. A bit strange, huh? Why is that? How come?
Celebrity.
Yeah, but Mozart is also a kind of celebrity, but he's a dead celebrity, and the chances of him actually writing a letter to... Yeah, I know. Plus, you know, what are we selling? We're not selling just, you know, sex. We're selling interpretation of sex. Maybe both, I don't know, you know, whatever you choose to do. You understand what I'm saying? Interpretation is the thing that we sell. Now, that's very interesting. Whose interpretation are we selling? When you have a pianist playing solo, yeah, okay. When you have an orchestra, is it a conductor's interpretation? This is really the most important question or perspective through which to look at the culture of a specific organization or society. You know what? Instead of me speaking about it, I already wasted too much of my time, of your time. Let's look. Different conductors, different cultures. What do you think about this guy? Would you like to work with this guy? Would you like this guy to be the Prime Minister of Great Britain? Look at him.
Thank you.
Enough. How many of you would like to work with this guy as a boss? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4.5, 5. How many would not? 5,000. How many don't care at all? There are also a few. Why would you like to work with him? Because?
Passionate.
What?
He's passionate.
He's passionate? Wait till you see the next one. Maybe, you know. Okay, relatively to a bank, what?
Expressive about being
over elaborate.
Over elaborating? Oh. That's positive or negative? Okay. What's positive about him? Maybe one thing. The guy knows everything. Did you see? Not only he knows, he's telling you. He's telling you, and not only he's telling you, he's telling you in a specific way. Be my orchestra. Sing the first note of Don Giovanni. Just sing, oh, until I stop you. Okay? Ready? Let's go. Now, if you don't stop with me, I feel even more redundant than I think. So, look at me. Again. Great. You see? Muti, this guy, has the best orchestra, well, in Italy. One of the best in Europe. La Scala of Milano. And he conducts him like this. Look. I'm sorry. I was distracted. Little. So not only you know what to do, you also know what will happen to you if you don't. And this could be a little bit of a problem, because the guy knows everything. The guy doesn't leave any gap, any space in which anybody else can say something, because he knows. 2 minutes? 2 minutes to what? Really? Wow, I'm really bad. Okay, so we have to contrast this with something else. We've already seen the other conductor who's dancing. And dancing, again, implies trust rather than knowing everything the other one should be doing. But maybe this is not enough. Maybe we have to try something even more. Let me scroll here and invite you to look at the first conductor we've seen together. Remember the happy guy? But you'll tell me what happens here. Is he less happy or what is it? Look here. It's the same guy, or a better hairdo. Why is he like that? Have you seen that there was a soloist in the orchestra? Now, Kleiber, that's the name of this guy, is still the boss, but look. Did you see the invitation to the soloist to come in? Now, what is he doing? He's not telling the guy, look, I'm in the cafeteria, call me when you're done. He's actually with him, supporting him, but how? Did you see that? Does he know better than the soloist? Not really. What he does, actually, is to create the conditions for this guy to actually invent. How does he do that? He does it by means of control, which are exactly opposite to those of Muti, the dictator we saw at the beginning. Muti tells you what to do. Now, Kleiber, have you seen just towards the end, and then there's a moment where his eyes go like that. Did you see that? Huh? Yeah. Now, you know what happens at this specific moment? Gravity in the room is gone. So the guy can... Now... He can jump as beautifully as a prima ballerina from the Covent Garden. Not as I, like an elephant, but beautiful. How come? Simply because... Not because the conductor told him, you know, if I look at you and I tell you, now, jump, doesn't really help. It's not about telling. It's about doing something that will make you believe, that make the gravity in your head go away and believe that you can fly. And then you fly where? To somewhere he doesn't know, actually. That is too short, I know, to actually get into it. But being ignorant and creating the conditions for somebody else to actually discover something that you might not know yourself is the goal of the great conductor. Just to say goodbye, I'll bring in my great teacher, Leonard Bernstein. He did exactly the same, only not on a professional level, but on a human level. The dialogue he had with his players, not only with them, but with everybody in the audience, consisted of trying to find out together what is the meaning of what we do. Now, the wonderful thing about meaning is that it can only be created through relations and through dialogue. You know, if you close yourself over there, a great genius can stand here, not me, myself, and speak words of wisdom, but he doesn't do anything. The moment you let it in, and you have this, you know, something coming from outside, what you see, what your colleagues might say, or I might say, and this enters into dialogue with what you already have in there, then something new can happen. Bernstein was the master of dialogues, and therefore I want to say goodbye with a very short dialogue by Bernstein. I'm so glad you like it. First of all, just to be fair, go on YouTube and watch the whole thing. Haydn 88 Finale, Bernstein, and you'll find it. It's so good, and I'm glad you like it. Just one word of warning, guys, you don't start this way, okay? Don't go back to your work or office or the family and start doing all kinds of... But the wonderful thing is, just to give it, I don't know, you can say many things about it. I find Bernstein to be the absolute, not keynote speaker, as I'm trying to be now, but keynote listener. Somebody who can really set the agenda just by listening to other people and, of course, communicating and reacting to what they do. So I wish you all to become wonderful keynote listeners. Thank you so much. Thank you.